Yeah. Hey, Shannon.
Thank you, everyone, and thank you all very much for coming along. And I can see that the pound free pizza works really well. Obviously, I need to think about the words I use because I'm probably going to trip over them as well. I thought perhaps first of all, do you want to ask me, start off by asking me a question and we'll kick off from there? Okay. Well, I thought I'd start off in answer to that question, really think about me rather than the research, just to give you a bit of background about who I am. I'm a relatively new professor at the university, only been a professor since September. I'm kind of a bit of an accidental professor. In my private life, I've got into sports activities quite late on. So I'm actually a master's athlete and take part in athletics. I've got some prizes here for a few things you can think about what I do. I'm hoping to compete at the World Masters Championships next summer in France. So, my first question to you would be, what athletic event do you think I'm going to be doing at this competition? Don't think any of you will know. Go for it.
Sally.
Okay. Keep it within traditional athletics.
Okay.
So, things like, you know, sprinting, hurdling, high jump, long jump. Probably not, no. But actually a good guess, because I do some hurdling.
Javelin?
No, I also do some javelin, but I'm not very good. That is actually a possibility. Good possibility. Who else? No, definitely not. Hammer. Very close, because I do throw the hammer. But I'm actually a bit small for kind of that sort of level. No? I think who said heptathlon? I'll give you a prize. Whisper, 12? Yeah. Yeah, there's a possibility I'll do heptathlon. It might be long jump, it might be triple jump. We'll see how things go. Other thing is, how many cats do you think I have? I do like kittens, but seven is getting a bit extreme. No? Two? No? Three? Who said three? You're getting much older. Okay, we'll leave it there. I'll see if I can think of other things as we go along. In terms of my research, this talk or the idea behind this came from work I've previously done with developing collaborative travel apps. Which I can tell you a little bit more about in a moment. And from that work emerged some ideas to do with problems to do with reciprocity and whether we can kind of deal with some of these problems using ideas from the Internet of Things. So I'll just set a bit of context really, and then I know that Sam wants to ask me other questions. If I just kind of flick down through here, because I brought some sort of props with me, I won't look about initially. We had a project called Sixth Sense Transport, and in this project we developed a number of travel collaboration apps, initially starting off with working with people in campsites in a tourism domain. Then we branched out and we started working with village communities, and then we worked with an urban fringe housing estate. And one of the things that emerged from this work was we had a lot of problems with lots of people wanting to offer help, but not many people wanting to kind of take up offers of help. So for instance, the apps would enable people to share a collection of shopping, so someone could post a shopping request onto a location. Is people were offering to get shopping for people, but no one was asking for the help or accepting the help. And then of course we looked at some of the theory behind this, and there was a problem to do with people want to feel in balance with their help requests and their offers of help. And so people don't like feeling in debt, you know, so what we realised was that actually this is an increasing problem in various sectors of society. So like for instance, if you take something like the ageing population, these are people who often need help but are very reluctant to ask for help. And one of the things we did with some of our later work was we particularly tried to work with communities where people needed various forms of help. So like village communities where there were people living without cars who were very sort of restricted in their access opportunities. But what we found was this kind of problem pervaded things still. So for instance, we have participants saying, well, I wouldn't be a good participant for your study because I can't offer to help people because I don't have a car. And then, you know, we'd have to talk to them about, well, actually, we quite want you to take part because you can actually ask for lifts. So that sort of got our attention and we started thinking about this a lot more. I mean, just to give you an idea of some of the things in the apps that we developed. So the idea of the apps is that we put people into a social network. So we worked with existing communities of people, or in the campsite context, the contrived communities. People came together and stayed at the campsite. The app had a kind of tracking application in the background. You couldn't ever see where an individual person was, but you got an idea of where the group was moving around. So I think, yeah, it shows up on this animation. You can see sort of patterns of movement, so people could kind of move back and forth across time and actually kind of begin to understand that other people might be doing the same sort of daily routines as them. And then the idea was that might actually trigger them to think about maybe they could collaborate in some of their travel. And also in the app we had sort of fairly simple messaging systems. People could message the whole group, or they could message individuals once they'd organised some kind of collaboration. I mean, none of this is particularly technically difficult. So, you know, I'm guessing looking around the room because I don't recognise people from my school of tourism, but there's probably going to be people from computer science who are thinking, you know, what's the technical difficulty here, and there isn't really. Some of this is quite sort of simplistic stuff. But what's quite interesting from my point of view as a social scientist and geographer in terms of sort of understanding some of the human-centred issues around this. You know, from that, as I say, we've begun to get interested in this issue to do with reciprocal behaviour and how we might actually address that. And then for any of you, I don't know, how many people understand the Internet of Things, or at least know roughly what it means? I can sort of see a show of hands. So there's, you're probably going to know more than me, you lot, okay? So my kind of sort of social scientist explanation of the Internet of Things is that we have an increasing number of objects around us in day-to-day life that are beginning to sense things about the environment they're in. So that can be things like your mobile phone, you know, which clearly can pick up things like your location, and it's got all sorts of other sensors in there. But also, more basic objects can sense things. So you can actually rig up a kettle, for instance, and a kettle can sense whether it's been used or not. Now, I give the kettle example because my kettle actually knows quite a lot about me, because I have various routines of using the kettle. So my kettle would pick up quite quickly if something was different, because, you know, on a school day we get up and I put the kettle on at a particular time of day, you know, and that's when I'm making a cup of tea for myself and my son. And so if that didn't happen, my kettle would be potentially, or could be potentially, aware of what's going on, something's not quite right. So there's a variety of ways in which we can increasingly use objects to pick up things about the environment, and those objects can share information with other objects and begin to build up some kind of intelligence and draw conclusions. Now, we're interested in this from this sort of collaborative sharing communities point of view, because there's a way that objects can be go-betweens. So, you know, a lot of people here are sat with a cup of tea or coffee, and we often use things like coffee as a way of sort of socialising. You know, we go and meet people over a cup of coffee. And so we were thinking how objects might actually help people deal with this problem of asking other people for help in various ways. So I've got an example here, which is fraught with all sorts of problems, which I'll explain. We've got a woman, June, who's been ill. but she's actually very reluctant to ask people for help, and you know, so she's stuck at home. Soon her car's got a sensor in it, it actually knows it's not been used for several days, which is unusual. Fridge can have sensors in, it's picked up that there's food running low. And these devices can communicate and begin to work out there's something odd going on here. And actually one of the things they can do is communicate with other objects and identify that there's someone in the area, there's a car at the supermarket at the moment that belongs to one of her friends. And that car knows from its routines that it's likely to go past her house. And so this is the kind of thing where there's an opportunity where the objects might actually be able to sense things and intervene. So it could be something like the object asks a friend to buy the milk, which is in the supermarket, and she knows she'll go past and can check on Jude. So that's a sort of very simple example. I mean, as my partner says, this is fraught with problems because he just goes, oh, Jude's gone on holiday then, you know, so. See all sorts of issues embedded here. But that kind of gives you a bit of an idea of what we've been thinking about in taking these collaborative travel apps further forward. Okay.
How does your research
show us the challenges? Okay, societal challenges. I suppose for me, it's been quite important in my work that I try to address things which are, you know, current issues for society, politically current issues. I mean, this work stems from, a call for projects to address a transport challenge. And the main transport challenge that I wanted this earlier work to address was really to do with climate change and reducing car dependence and the carbon footprint of travel. I would say, though, that as this work has emerged, it's probably begun to tackle other issues. And I mean, one of the things which I think is perhaps more interesting that's emerging now is actually issues to do with the way certain people are excluded by not having access to cars, and how there might be the opportunities to try to deal with those sorts of problems. So that's certainly an area that, you know, I'm quite keen to pursue more. So there's lots of sort of inequalities to do with our ability to move in all sorts of different ways. So not just through things like use of vehicles, but also through things like being able to connect to the internet, like I'm connected to now. You know, often you've got the same sort of groups who are excluded in various ways. I mean, one of the interesting things about the Internet of Things is that it might actually be ways that people can interact with the internet where they don't actually have to use the typical devices we use, like laptops or tablets or smartphones. And they might actually be able to interact in different ways, which is quite an interesting opportunity.
As a social scientist, how do you deal with complex technological issues in your research?
Badly. it's been quite a steep learning curve for me, coming from a kind of non-technical background to now working with computer scientists and digital artists on projects. I've had to learn a whole new language that people use. And to some extent, they've had to learn some of my language as well. And there have been some quite entertaining moments along the way. There was some early on in the Sixth Sense Transport Project when we were having discussions and trying to sort out the costs. There was all this discussion of the platform, which platform we're going to use. And me and a transport planner were sat in this meeting, and we were kind of just looking at each other really puzzled. Weren't really clear what this was all about. And then suddenly the kind of penny dropped. You know, we realised, of course, what this is about, and the computer scientists among you will know. The guy I was working with from Southampton went, oh, thank God for that. I thought we were going to have to be thinking about how high it was, how big it was, whether we'd need a safety net. Those of you who don't know, when we're talking about kind of computer platforms, it's things like, would we be using the Apple platform, or would we be using Android? Android platform. Yeah, there's kind of little moments like that, and there's still occasions where I feel kind of tuned out in meetings for a moment when I think, yeah, they're talking about that thing again where I don't really quite get what it is. The other side to that is actually within social science. There are quite big disciplinary divides in social science, and actually sometimes they are much bigger than the shift between, say, a geographer working with a computer scientist. And it's been quite challenging working with, say, we've worked with a developmental psychologist, and you know, she had very specific ideas about the way you'd run trials. And I had to kind of explain to her why these particular ways of doing things wouldn't work in a tourism context. So for instance, she'd talk about, you know, you'd have to have a control group. And I'd be saying, well, I'm working on a campsite with a very fluid group of people. There's no way I'm going to find 10 people to do this, never mind another 10 people who could be a control group. And how are we going to control anything about what they do? It's just really difficult. And she found that quite challenging, that, you know, I had this much more sort of cavalier approach to research. In actual fact, that fitted, you know, the computer scientists were reasonably happy about that. So there's interesting issues there.
Okay. As an academic in the School of Tourism, how's your research related to students?
Okay, apart from the fact that I've worked at a campsite, you can probably see that my research isn't obviously situated within tourism, and my areas as a lecturer are predominantly within the field of event management, and I also teach on events and leisure marketing program, and I guess that my sort of background as a lecturer is more on the sort of leisure studies side of things. You know, to be honest, a lot of the research I do, you know, many students would find quite difficult to actually see how this connects with tourism, leisure, and events. And I think one of the things that I try to do with students is sort of show them how leisure, tourism, events, they're not sort of little boxes that sort of exist independent of everything else around them. And really, that actually they're sort of part of this sort of wide problem in society. So they need to kind of think sort of beyond that. And obviously, of course, some of the things we're talking about here, like the Internet of Things, can be very relevant to all sorts of things in tourism, leisure, and events in slightly different ways. So it's kind of finding ways to contextualise that for them. I mean, in fact, I use some of the data from the project will be collected at the campsite with students as data they can actually use to work on with a research methods assignment, and it works very successfully. It does take a bit of a leap sometimes to actually sort of see how this fits together. And actually sometimes my colleagues ask me what I'm doing, and I think they wonder what on earth I'm doing in the School of Tourism. But for me, it's just, I think you kind of go where interesting research takes you, you know, and that's taken me away from the work I initially did, which tended to be tourism, transport, geography orientated into sort of new areas.
Last question. Are you currently working in the EU, or do you have any plans for research in the future?
In terms of where this is going, I'm hoping with Erin this afternoon to finally submit an ESRC proposal, which is going to try to sort of take some of these ideas forward. Other than that as well, along the way, particularly in writing this particular proposal, there's been various things that have popped up along the way. So for instance, one of the things that I'm quite interested in is reciprocal leisure. So in coming from my background as looking at sort of transport and tourism and leisure, one of the things that tends to happen is as people get older, their leisure worlds begin to get smaller. And particularly as people feel more uncomfortable driving, or when they maybe give up using the car, one of the things that tends to happen is they tend to stop doing leisure activities because they'll ask for help with things like getting to the shops, getting to the doctors, but much less so with leisure activities. So you often find that older people withdraw from certain areas of leisure. So that's been an area that I've been interested in, and I've been having some discussions about reciprocal leisure and how people might be able to pass on skills, say like, you know, how to go fishing, you know, and you might be able to share that with someone younger who can actually provide the transport to take you there so you can carry on doing it. But on the way, came across an initiative which, oh, I know there's one in Southampton and all other parts of the UK, where they're now taking the concept of a hospital ward out to the community. So the idea is they identify people who are at risk of medical problems and then try to intervene with people in the community so they can kind of monitor people better and try to stop them coming into hospital. But the interesting thing about this is that these people are isolated individuals who are kind of connected maybe by a medical condition, but because they're not in hospital, they don't get the kind of support they would normally get from meeting other people with similar conditions. So there's a quite interesting idea around how the Internet of Things and reciprocal support might actually be able to help these people who are in these virtual wards, who at the moment are kind of disconnected from one another, and how they might be able to sort of share things and sort of support, but also kind of share helping one another in various ways, like they would if they were in a hospital ward. So that's something that's kind of also emerging as well. If you don't mind, I've got a little video that if the Wi-Fi connection is working, we'll have a look at. Yeah, if I can get this to go, it's actually a video. So I'm just going to make sure the sound's not on so I can talk a bit over it. Again, sort of shows where some of our ideas have come from. This was actually an activity at the Royal Geographical Society conference, which we did about 18 months ago, where we used the smartphone app that we developed, and we brought some of our project smartphones with us. And we gave people an activity to do around, the RGS is based in London, West London, and people had a little map to follow, and they set off with their maps, and they had various tasks. So they had tasks like they had to get an item to a place they weren't going to. So they had to collaborate with other people in their community to move these things around. And so you can see there's various participants walking their route. They're tracked, they can see where they're on the map, and there's various places of interest where some of them have to go and others don't. But here, can you see this beach ball? What was quite interesting, what sort of sparked our interest here, was what appeared to happen was these objects began to direct the people. Because inadvertently, the way we posted some of the messages into the system, it kind of implied a beach ball was asking for help. And what happened was people kind of just went, oh, okay, I'll help this beach ball. Or here there's a tennis ball being handed over. And it was quite strange how actually it didn't appear to be someone asking for the beach ball, the tennis ball, but the beach ball saying, I need to get somewhere else. And here there's a fly swatter being moved around. And that got us thinking about how people seem to respond better to this object rather than someone asking something to be somewhere or trying to ask for help themselves. And we've done this kind of activity in a number of conference settings now, and people get quite imaginative with what they do and how they do things and the things that they request help with. And I think I think at the end of this, someone brings back some chocolate. Someone asks for some chocolate. There were all sorts of things that took place within there. Yeah, this I think is the fly swatter being taken. This is a conference reception, and she's collecting the fly swatter from the conference reception. And actually, it was quite fun. The people we gave various people, because we needed places where people could drop off equipment. And actually, it was quite interesting how the people holding the equipment got quite excited about it, because they kept getting given other items. And then people came and collected those items, and they kind of enjoyed that sort of experience. I think this is going back into the conference centre there. Yeah, and that's it. There was some Maltesers or something that someone had asked for at that point, so they got swapped over. over to you for any questions, really.
I'm interested in your idea of reciprocity. beach ball. Just expand it a bit, beach ball.
So I suppose when we've kind of thought about things, you know, there's quite a lot of collaborative travel systems out there now of various ways where you can, you know, request lifts, but they're very much centred around, you know, people have to ask for my lift to go to such and such, and another person has to respond. What we noticed in these workshops where we use these, you know, silly props like the beach ball and the fly swatter, when we posted messages, you know, we posted messages like beach ball needs to get to, you know, late hall or somewhere like that. It was just this sort of slight shift from, you know, Janet urgently needs the beach ball, can you take it to the hall, to, oh, there's a beach ball here that's requesting my help. So, yeah, it began to get us thinking about how objects might actually understand that they need to be somewhere else. You know, so maybe some request has come through the network and the object knows that it needs to be somewhere else where it can be useful. So instead of a person asking for it, the object itself voices that request. Do you see the sort of slight shift? And that kind of changes things potentially for the person who needs it, because they're no longer requesting it, because the object is voicing that request. That's the idea.
Are you just looking at the UK, or are you looking at other, like, social media, like, different applications? Because if you to use what you are doing, and then you country or the community, and then you do it, and then you need a dialysis machine. Would that dialysis machine not be able to then get the message, and then be able to get the message, so they don't have to go to it, but then they go around, so on, and put off, like, maybe how you adapt to it. You found that users will have community that perhaps doesn't have the same
That's really interesting. I mean, our work has been very UK-based, so you know, I can't necessarily kind of answer that question directly. You can see that there would be opportunities in other countries, other contexts. And I guess as well, I mean, I've got very limited knowledge on the area, but I know that in many developed countries, actually, smartphone ownership is quite high, at least at the sort of basic end smartphones. And actually, that's often the way that people connect to the internet, rather than, you know, they don't have things like laptops, etc. And so, you know, there could be interesting opportunities there, as you say. And I think that's an interesting area in terms of also how, where you might actually have much greater than this necessity for help, and yeah, so I think that's a very good avenue to look at. Okay, anyone else, or we wrap up then?
Thank you, Jenna. This one-to-one week, so I hope to see you again next month. For those lucky for you who have the tokens, you have to change it. You can't wait a day or two and they cook now, so...
Well, you can sell it on to somebody.
Yeah, thank you.